Dear audience, please rise and put your hands together for our esteemed guest, Mr. Subra Suresh.
Future belongs to those who believe in the beauty of their dreams. By Eleanor Roosevelt. A very wonderful morning to everyone present here. I am Bhavya Jha from 10IGCSE.
And I am Sasmit Mohanty. It gives us great pleasure to welcome you to GIIS's very own leadership lecture series with our esteemed guest, Mr. Subra Suresh, the fourth president of Nanyang Technological University.
I am ecstatic to announce that the Global Schools Foundation has officially completed 20 years since its inception. On that note, let us watch a video.
What does it take to make a leader of tomorrow? A leader is forged by fire, shaped, reshaped, their metal tested. Resilience and strength, carefully honed. Yet a leader must also be like water, filling the cracks in a world rich in diversity, attuned to its complexities, flowing, adapting, changing. For a leader of tomorrow sails along on the winds of change, their minds purified by the rarefied air of lofty thoughts and high ideals. The jet streams of innovation and invention, neither of which can be enabled without space. Space that can both contain and expand, mold and liberate. A foundation. For a leader must stand on solid ground. Responsibility breeds sustainability. Wisdom is cultivated by respect for this earth. Building the foundations for tomorrow's leaders begins here. Global Schools Foundation, celebrating 20 years of premium education.
What a truly inspiring video.
Now, we invite our chairman and co-founder of Global Schools Foundation, Mr. Atul Tamanikar, to deliver his introductory message.
A very good morning to everyone. Dear Professor Subra Suresh, respected guests, teachers, students, and friends. It's a great honor for us to have amongst us the very distinguished president of Nanyang Technological University and the distinguished university professor at the GIIS Leadership Lecture Series being held at the GIIS SMART Campus in Singapore today. Professor Subra is a legend in the research world and has made immense contributions to advancing science, technology, education, research, and innovation through his scholarship and leadership. Professor Subra is among the very few distinguished world leaders who have delivered a lecture at the GIIS Leadership Lecture Series and given our students the opportunity to know them firsthand and in-person interactions with the leadership of such outstanding caliber. For this, We are truly grateful to you for your kind presence. In our lifetime, many of us aspire to achieve at least one doctorate degree. For Professor Subra, you have done wonders. You have 18 honorary doctorate degrees from institutions around the world to your achievements. That's really, really amazing. The visit of Professor Subra is happening as we are celebrating the 20th anniversary of the Global Schools Foundation, which makes this occasion a truly special one. Our not-for-profit foundation was established to cater to the needs of diverse communities looking for an education that prepared them to be global leaders and represented top quality education, embedded universal and ethical values, and local cultural experiences for their children. In the past two decades, GSF has come a long way from educating 48 students to now 32,000 students globally. GSF is now an institution representing 35 international schools in 11 countries. It is also a flag bearer of the communities from 70 nationalities that have trusted us with their children's transformational and overall development. It is true GSF started with the Global Indian International School, of which this SMART campus is a flagship campus. We realized this campus generated a strong interest among the educators from around the world when we launched this SMART campus in 2018. Which took 3 years to design by 80 teachers from our schools and a gentleman who had written a book with Harvard on designing 21st century schools. We are happy to inform you that the GIIS SMART Campus is presently being featured on the National Geographic television channel. This campus is one of the world's largest SMART campuses in schools category, and I know you just shared NTU is also one of the most leading smart universities. So this campus has over 100 next generational classrooms and 42 skill studios and labs. The smart campus is a fine example of how schools and edtech are intrinsically intertwined and has kept itself ahead of the curve with a constant teaching and learning innovations by evolving with the times and providing education through new age learning means. Our smart classrooms, and including this very own smart basketball courts, are centers of excellence, be it academics or sports, which make effective use of technology to give amazing learning experiences and achieve the best learning outcomes for a new generation of students. The ecosystem in different international schools is designed to fulfill the needs of young alpha generations of students through digital technology, hybrid learning platforms, and new age sustainable learning materials. This is true for all our international schools, including the One World International School, which is a stone's throw away from NTU, and the Dwight School in Korea, Harrods International School in Cambodia, Regent International School in Malaysia, Damascola in the Philippines, and many more. Students from Korea to Japan to the United Arab Emirates and Saudi Arabia have benefited from the premium skills-based education that GSF schools provide. In Japan, over 70% of our students are Japanese nationals. And to serve these communities, we will be opening 3 new schools in Osaka, Tsukuba, which is a R&D city, and Tokyo, in addition to existing 3 schools in Tokyo. So in Japan, we will have a total of 6 schools by the end of 2023. We have made it to our mission to give 21st century skills through our 9 GEMS framework to students from all walks of life to nurture them into global citizens who practice compassion, kindness, and empathy. Future skills include the ability to code and scale through hackathons, build robots, and turn artificial intelligence into meaningful use in life for life-saving innovations, as well as great personality and communication skills. In addition to STEM, we have complementing radio skills, TV and film presentation skills, culinary skills, visual arts, performing arts, and language skills. Our schools are ensuring that the future generations are sharpened with all-round skills and capabilities. But what really sets our schools apart is the fact that while innovation takes the center stage in teaching and learning, we are deeply rooted in our identities, in our values of universal brotherhood, upholding national culture, and encouraging traditional values among the communities. GSF's cultural bodies work closely with the local communities, such as community organizations, people's association, in every geography to ensure that cultural roots remain strong among the new generation of leaders. This is done through dedicated programs that teach Japanese, Karnataki, Hindustani vocals, contemporary Bharatanatyam and Odissi dances to students, and have comprehensive language programs to allow to flourish the mother tongue. So be it Mandarin, Tamil, Sanskrit, Telugu, Khmer, French, Korean, or Japanese, our students have the option to learn languages of their choice. And if I'm not mistaken, generally students take about 3 languages in the school with the optional 4th language, spoken language. Besides this, GSF gives them a chance to learn ancient skills such as Japanese origami, abacus, and maintain strong links with their traditional roots while training to be global citizens. Our journey in education excellence was an initiative recommended by none other than Mr. Narayana Murthy, who is a GSF patron and a member of the advisory board, who recommended benchmarking our school organizations for performance excellence. In 2006, we adopted the Malcolm Baldrige National Quality Award framework for education excellence and decided to benchmark all our schools and all our initiatives in innovation, business, and governance excellence. Malcolm Baldrige, for some of you, is a national quality award in the US administered by the Baldrige Performance Excellence Program, which is based and managed by the National Institute of Standards and Technology, or NIST, which is an agency of the US Department of Commerce. I'm proud to share that the Asian national quality organizations, such as Enterprise Singapore, Asia Pacific Quality Organization, Institute of Directors, etc., have awarded GSF schools with more than 400 international performance excellence awards in governance, innovation, organizational best practices, and academic excellence, and many more. The GSF schools have presented over 200 white papers at different international quality forums for educational excellence, and have even been awarded for more than 60 white papers on best practices in education. Such initiatives on performance excellence and delivering high quality standards have benefited GSF school students immensely and are apparent in their scholastic and non-scholastic achievements. Over 87 students have been awarded IB World Topper and Near Perfect scores over the last few years. And over half of these were awarded in the last 2 exam board results. Over 45% of our graduating students score 40 and above in their IB exams. Over 84% of our graduating IGCSE Cambridge cohorts for the O-levels have scored A stars and A's in all subjects. And let me mention here that these rankings that we're looking at compare with some of the best rankings in the UK Cambridge system schools. Some of our world's best ranked universities, including our very own NTU, which is now ranked 30th globally, attract GSF students on a very, very large scale. The GSF students have gone on to achieve success in different fields, for example, working in space exploration at SpaceX, or top research and financial institutions, or success in representing Miss India 2020 and Miss Singapore Universe 2021 are just examples of our alumni. Their all-round success is no doubt an outcome closely linked with the 9 GEMS holistic framework that we have and which we have implemented very successfully for the past 2 decades. Professor Subra's presence today is another humble attempt by our schools to give valuable experiential learning from such interactions to help them become the better next generation leaders. GSF schools are also designed for new age future skills learning so that the students will be able to expand the horizons of their minds, be innovative, be entrepreneurial, and be creative as well. They will develop into well-being, all-rounded global workforce and leaders who will go on to contribute towards the success and prosperity of the world they live in. All this is done through sustainable education, which is designed to incorporate a truly eco-friendly environment for all our students, teachers, and our communities. Now, as we celebrate 20 years of excellence, we are sincerely trying to evolve with the times and revolutionize the existing processes to take care of those students of the future. We are thrilled to see so many positive changes in the digital economies of today, which are encouraging our endeavor to be the best educational group for the future generations. And for this, I hope we will get the support of all the like-minded individuals who are keen to see our future generations flourish and become a great inspiration for our young citizens. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Let's watch another short video about the glorious institution we call home.
Leading edge technology, science, and sports.
Innovation, acceleration.
Space exploration.
Right here, right now, my future begins. It's hands-on, but it's also academically way up here. So I'm learning the skills I need to explore the universe. And I'm expanding my skill base with these next generation purpose-built studios. They adapt to a changing world. It's the future, and it's now.
Right here, right now. Technology gives me the opportunity to dive deep into research and innovation. With world-class educators to guide the way, I am best prepared for higher education and the university of my choice. New advances, new insights, mean new opportunities. And with them come new creative ways of problem solving. It's the future, and it's now.
Right here, right now, at these smart sports facilities, while best-in-class coaches are developing my strengths, guiding me to overcome my weaknesses, and bringing out the best that I can be. So I'm tech-empowered for better results, bringing my dream into reality. The future, it's now.
We are very happy to have in our midst Mr. Subra Suresh. He was nominated as the director of the U.S. National Science Foundation by none other than Barack Obama, the 44th President of the United States, and was unanimously confirmed by the U.S. Senate. He has also worked in several universities, including the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, MIT, and the Ivy League school, Brown. Having contributed greatly to the field of biomedical engineering, he, as of 2022, he has also led successfully 2 technology startups.
Today's GIIS Leadership Lecture Series will begin with Mr. Suresh speaking to the audience. This will be followed by a discussion with our student panelists who will take center stage with pertinent questions for Mr. Suresh. Without further ado, we would like to extend our greetings to Mr. Subra Suresh and kindly request him to address the audience. Sir, please.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you very much for inviting me. It's a real pleasure and a privilege to have the opportunity to meet all of you and to spend a few minutes discussing some topics of mutual interest, especially you as future leaders will face in the years to come. When I received this invitation to come and visit here today, I thought about what I should talk about. In the end, I thought I'll pick a topic that's sufficiently broad, which probably is on your minds, and none of what I'm going to say is new to you, but perhaps I can add one or two perspectives that could be slightly different from what you may have thought about, and then we can discuss that later. So the title of my presentation, very broadly, is Learning, Technology, and Humanity. And it's a very broad topic, but I'm going to focus on a few points, primarily at the intersection of where technology is going to take us, and especially take you in this century, some of the pros and cons of this technology, and especially how this technology will intersect with humanity. And there are so many angles to this, and I don't claim to know most of them, and nor does anyone can claim to understand the full impact of all of this. So hopefully it'll be a conversation starter for us. I want to begin with the rapid pace of technology, and that's ever accelerating, and the impact of which we are just beginning to grasp. So let's go back in history, and let's pose a question. Whenever a new technology came into existence, how long did it take for that technology to be adopted by the first 50,000 users around the world? Let's start with television or radio or telephone. So here is a slide that is taken from data that appeared a few years ago. When the telephone first came into existence, it took 75 years for 50 million users around the world to adopt the technology, 75 years. For the automobile, it was 64 years. So you can go back, even electricity, which we take for granted, without which we cannot live anymore, took 46 years for only 50 million people to use it. Credit cards, 22 years. Television, 22 years, credit card, 28 years, and so on. Computer, 14 years. Mobile phones, which all of us carry, 12 years. Even the internet took 7 years. Facebook, 4 years. WeChat, 1 year. Pokemon Go, 19 days. And if you look at 2 years ago during COVID, Zoom was probably used by more than 50 million users in a few seconds around the world. So that's the rapid pace of technology that we live with. We are also still in the middle of what we call the fourth industrial revolution, or Industry 4.0. And it has many, many nuances to this, but I want to start with four macro trends that influence our day-to-day life. I already mentioned technology adoption, particularly the rapid pace of development of technology and adoption of technology. But there are other aspects to this which were made abundantly clear during COVID on a global scale. Social stresses, inequality. So for example, during COVID, we were all forced around the world to connect with one another online, including getting education online in most parts of the world. So there are 7 billion people on the planet. Most children around the world had no choice but to receive education online. But only 50% of the world has access to the internet. So what good is online education if half of the children around the world, more than half the children around the world, don't have access to the internet? So that's one of the issues. COVID also made it very clear to us that certain segments of global society were disproportionately affected by the stresses caused by a global pandemic. Inequality, inequality of opportunity, inequality in accessing education, inequality in digital access, gender and racial inequalities and biases that take place. For example, in the US, a disproportionately large number of jobs were lost by women and underrepresented minorities during COVID. So these kinds of social stresses continue to exist, and technology hasn't addressed them. So technology alone cannot be the solution. Then there are challenges. At a time when we could connect globally through technology, and during COVID, without technology, we could not have connected both personally and professionally. Technology has torn down all the walls and barriers. But at the same time, in the last 2 years, because of the pandemic and because of geopolitical factors, we have tall walls erected around the world as well. And as a result of this, we have a tension between globalization on the one hand and going in the opposite direction to globalization on the other hand because of geopolitical factors. And that tension will continue to exist. We have grand challenges. Unfortunately, previous generations have left for you challenges that are very, very demanding and difficult, including climate change. The whole issue of sustainability in the broadest sense, including in governance, in everything we do, and various other issues to solve, and I'll come back to it in more detail later. Then we have aging population around the world, including in Singapore, with very low birth rate. And as a result of this, the younger generation, not just here, but in most parts of the world, including the US and Europe and Japan, the younger generation has to shoulder the burden of not only supporting themselves, but also supporting their parents and grandparents. And so this is an extra burden on your generation and the previous generation. So these are some of the challenges that we face. There are also opportunities, tremendous opportunities of technology. I mean, Chairman Atul just mentioned this, how a school like yours can take technology and use it to the fullest extent in education. There are economic opportunities. For example, through technology, can we leapfrog developing countries? So Africa, which has been relatively underdeveloped compared to the rest of the world, will have a population that will be young and that will be dynamic 20 years from now. So for most parts of Africa, can we leapfrog technology rather than having copper telephone lines, which you had to undo to put fiber optics to satellite technology to latest 5G, can we leapfrog and go right to the latest technology to improve the lives and livelihoods of people? That's one opportunity. Socially, what are the things we can do? Can digital technologies make lifelong learning better from birth to near end of life? And how can we make the quality of life better, learning better, et cetera, not just in schools and universities, but throughout life? So if so, what does it take? So let's start with Industry 4.0, or Fourth Industrial Revolution. So the first industrial revolution started in the 18th century in Scotland. The second industrial revolution, of course, led to mechanization. The third industrial revolution created the internet and global connectivity, and even gave rise to the beginning of robotics and other areas. The fourth industrial revolution, which we are in the middle of, is defined as the unique and unprecedented convergence among the physical world, the digital world, and the biological world. And that's very unusual because biology and health and medicine are part of the digital world. So there are a few examples of this. Without computing and computer science, the Human Genome Project could not have been done because we couldn't have processed the data 20 years ago. The entire human genome was partly precipitated by advances in computer science. So it's not just about biology and medicine. Same way, you can think of a scenario, I say it as a hypothetical scenario, but it's possible today. Let's say you need a hip implant. You can use digital technologies like 3D printing. So you can do an image of your particular hip. You can, for your particular bone density, and you can create a 3D printed part. It can be a metal, ceramic, or a polymer. And you can do through surgery, you can implant a chip in this implanted device, and the chip can be connected to your mobile phone. So post-surgery, as you walk from your gait, you can, your physician can analyze whether the surgery was successful or not. If there are any subsequent changes, those changes can be monitored. And if something goes wrong, the physician and you can be alerted. So that's an example of the unique convergence of the physical world, the digital world, and the biological world. There are many, many such examples that one can think about. So given this, the ingredients of the fourth industrial revolution are robotics, AI and data science, blockchain, artificial intelligence, Internet of Things, autonomous systems, ground-based, as well as drones and many others, personalized medicine, smart medicine, precision medicine, and many, many other technologies that have come into existence. But interestingly enough, the fourth industrial revolution has brought to the forefront something that was not as much an issue in the three previous industrial revolutions. As human intelligence and machine intelligence compete for day-to-day dominance in our day-to-day lives, is there a possibility that humanity itself will be either slightly or severely altered by technology? That question has not been that much in the forefront until now, and I'll focus on that a little bit more in the next slide. So technology connecting with humanity is nothing new, but technology significantly altering the fundamental basis of humanity is something that we need to be watchful about. And ethics and policy and principles play a very important role in this. So before I go into some of those topics, let me just take a couple of minutes to talk about disruptive technologies. This is not my idea. This is a study that was done by McKinsey, the global consulting firm, a few years ago. According to them, by 2025 to 2030, these are some of the areas that they think will be at the forefront. Of course, predictions are only predictions, and they change very quickly. This is as of a couple of years ago. From mobile internet to advanced materials to cloud technologies to advanced robotics to autonomous vehicles to IoT, etc. But you also see some old things like advanced oil and gas exploration, carbon-based technologies, which we are trying to avoid. They also exist because, unfortunately, you cannot get rid of them that quickly. This week is COP27 in Egypt. And this is very much front and center, especially with respect to developing countries. Energy storage, batteries, et cetera, come into this. So one of the questions that comes up is in the context of education and learning, as we adopt technology, what are some of the tensions between machine intelligence and human intelligence? And what are some of the trade-offs? So I just want to focus on one topic, that's values. And this is something that's, as the chairman mentioned, is emphasized in this school. So let's take human values. So as machines gather more and more massive data, big data, they connect them, they agglomerate them, they analyze them, they parse them across countries, across continents. How likely is it that individual human characteristics that uniquely define you as you and me as me are captured in that? And this is a fundamental question. So for example, let's take any of these values that is listed here: empathy, ethics, kindness, sympathy, dignity, compassion, trust. even siblings growing up in the same, it all depends on our life journeys, where we grow up, what culture we grow up in, what families we grow up. Even within the same family, brothers and sisters may grow up with slightly different, not exactly the same values. And we see this all over the world in every culture. So it is unique to the individual that's involved. So if human values are so individualistic, how likely is it that collectively, massive data that's gathered across the world will capture your unique characteristics and my unique characteristics? And are we likely to lose it if big data becomes ubiquitous? And this is something that we have to watch out for as we go for technology, especially in the 21st century. And this is one of the things that uniquely defines the fourth industrial revolution. So I just have two more slides. I want to address six issues in the context of technology intersecting with humanity. First, every industrial revolution before the current one has shown technology will disrupt lives, technology will dramatically change society, it'll eliminate tens of millions of jobs, but the previous three industrial revolutions have shown that ultimately, it could take several decades, it'll end up creating more jobs than it destroyed. But if the time lag between job destruction and job creation is quite long, then nobody will have the patience, especially with the rapid pace of technology, and that'll create revolutions. So one of the challenges with Industry 4.0, with the rapid pace of technology, is to reduce the time gap between elimination of jobs and creation of new jobs, new kinds of jobs. So that also creates an interesting question for entities like this, universities, schools, and young learners, is what kind of skills you need to rapidly change not just jobs, but profession, at a time when medicine is making it possible to live longer and longer. And unlike your parents and your grandparents, you're not only going to change jobs, you may change continents, you may change professions, and you may have a very different career 30 years from now than what you start with when you finish university. So that's an interesting question. So if that is the case, the question is, what is the minimum body of knowledge that you're supposed to possess when you leave school, when you leave GIIS, when you leave university? What is the minimum body of knowledge that you're supposed to possess? You cannot learn everything in 4 years in college. And whatever you learn will become outdated 5-10 years after you graduate. So the only way to survive is to learn how to learn, and you have a minimum body of knowledge. So as a university president in two different universities, I have worried about it, and every university faculty member worries about it. So what are some of the skills that you need when you leave school, high school, or when you leave university? Learning to think rationally and quantitatively is a very important skill. Learning to think in the face of uncertainty, because life is never fully deterministic, it's probabilistic. There is a probability of something happening or not happening. So when you have significant uncertainty, how do you make a decision? But you make a decision based on information and data and evidence, and how do you make it as quantitatively as possible when it's a subjective decision? So probabilistic thinking. Third is how to be good at technology, but not be a slave to technology, and how to mix values and humanity with technology. And humanity also means humanities and arts and social sciences. So what does an educated person mean? So I'm an engineer by training. I was told that in order to be a good human being, it's not enough you know how to solve equations and partial differential equations, how to design things. Have you read Shakespeare? Do you know how to appreciate music and the arts? That's very important. By the same token, if you're an arts major, and if you know nothing about coding, then what good is education? How can you be a productive citizen of the 21st century? So we have introduced at NTU something called minimum required courses in digital literacy for all our 23,000 undergraduate students. You cannot graduate without that. And that includes things like digital hygiene, how to respect somebody's digital space, ethics, and many other things. So these are some of the things that are going to be important to be an educated person of the 21st century, as opposed to when I was in high school a few decades ago, these topics were not even on the horizon. We didn't even have a landline phone or a mobile phone or the internet. So these were moot points at that time, but this is front and center for you. Definition of being human. So if technology becomes more and more dominant in our day-to-day lives, who decides what your humanity is? If you have an autonomous vehicle that on the one hand is going to hit a fellow human being or a dog or a cat, who programs it and who decides? Does it steer to the right or steer to the left? Is it a programmer in a car company, or is it like Tesla, or is it somebody else? Who decides? So there are so many ethical questions involved in the adoption, day-to-day adoption of technology, and how do you live with this? And so these are going to be more and more front and center, and how do we make sure that we don't lose that humanity, individual humanity, not just collective humanity. Both are important. So some people argue that we might reach a point of so-called singularity, and there is no agreement on this. Some people think that it may come as early as in the 2030s, by 2040 or so. The definition of this is the machine intelligence becomes almost as good as human intelligence in terms of making many decisions, if not all decisions. Some people think that day will never come because machines will never be as good as human intelligence. But whether it comes or not, one fact is clear: more and more of our day-to-day decisions will be made by machines, whether they are autonomous systems or something else, or big data agglomerated together. So here are the questions. We know that we as humans have intrinsic biases, conscious or unconscious. Will machine decisions make human bias worse? Will they exacerbate human bias, or will they reduce? Both are possible, but it depends on how you program your machines and what kind of data you use to program the machines. So it is possible that we can make things worse, and it is possible we can make things better. And there is already evidence that things like face recognition, the human biases based on the data you collect, if all the data collected on face recognition is for Caucasians, for example, will they discriminate against Chinese or Africans? Or if all the face recognition data are based on Chinese citizens, will they discriminate against non-Chinese faces? So these are all interesting questions that have also come to the fore in the context of the fourth industrial revolution. And also the other question is, if machines make more and more decisions, will humans have the opportunity to reverse them if we don't like them? Even if we can reverse them, can we reverse them in time so that no damage is done? Because things are getting faster and faster as well. So then we have every previous industrial revolution has shown that we have intended benefits of technology, but we also have unintended consequences. For example, during the Japanese samurai sword, there is beautiful metallurgy, material science that was done to coat and heat treat the steel to make a really sharp knife or blade, which were used for in wartime. It also makes a beautiful kitchen knife to cook. So a beautiful kitchen knife that has the latest in technology can be very beneficial for cooking, but it can also be a lethal murder weapon. It depends on how we use them. So it's the intended benefit and the intended or unintended consequence. But one thing that's clear from three previous industrial revolutions is that humans will intentionally or unintentionally misuse, and abuse technology. So for every intended benefit, there will be unintended consequence. So how do we maximize the benefits and minimize the unintended consequences? That's going to be a challenge in the fourth industrial revolution, more so than in the three previous industrial revolutions. And the last point is a very subtle point. Being imperfect and imprecise often makes us as humans. If you do a technology startup, as many of you will end up doing, or any other startup, social startup, you don't succeed. 95% of startups fail. So you learn by mistakes, you fail, you fall down. That's how you learn how to ride a bike. And so failure and imprecision and imperfection are integral part of being human. But technology is pushing us to be more and more precise, more and more perfect, and more immediate, especially in technologically advanced societies like Switzerland and Singapore. As a result of this, because there is a push, if you get an email or a text message, you feel compelled to respond immediately. If you don't respond, you get a reminder, why haven't you responded? So that's another example of not having enough time to reflect and think. So one of the questions is this push to precision and perfection and immediacy, will it make us less and less truthful and human? And will we lose some of the creativity that comes in being imperfect and imprecise in responding to technology in an urgent way? So what can we do? A few thoughts. Learning to learn is going to be key. And I mentioned a few areas where learning to think quantitatively, rationally, based on evidence, probabilistic thinking, et cetera, communication skills, a sense of fairness, sense of values, but proficiency in technology. That's a good combination skill to have. With that grounding, so not just mathematics, but also statistics and probability, and things like this can help. The intersection of physical, digital, and biological worlds. So not just learning physics and chemistry, but also learning biology beyond high school in university. So when I went to Indian Institute of Technology in Madras, it was a wonderful curriculum, but there was not a single course in biology. Later on in life, I realized when I went to biomedical engineering, there was a big gap in my education. I started learning with my daughter, who was in high school at that time, her biology course books, but within 2 days, she was way ahead of me. I couldn't catch up with her. So how do you balance that? So here are a few things. Digital literacy, digital hygiene, respecting somebody else's digital space, and having responsibility, social responsibility in social media, commitment to sustainability, sustainability in every sense of the word, not just environmental sustainability. Forever learning. Learning is not going to end when you leave school, when you leave university. I have to learn every day in my job, and there is no such thing as retirement from learning. It's lifelong, and it goes all the time. Training to manage information and misinformation. Unfortunately for your generation, this is so critical. So how do you distinguish between fact and fake news? How do you authenticate it? How do you know the veracity of information? And who do you trust? And how do you make that judgment? And this is going to be very, very critical. So verifying information before responding to it and reacting to it is going to be critical. Responsible innovation is going to be critical. So even if you study engineering or medicine or sciences, it is inevitable that you have an understanding of social sciences, human psychology, economic. You cannot study everything, but while you are deeply learning, you have deep learning of one subject, how do you make sure that you have at least the minimum knowledge in something else? So if you're an expert in technology, do you know anything about economics? If you don't, then you're not going to be very successful. Ethics is going to be critical to all of this. Of course, these are motherhood and apple pie statements, but it is even more important today than for previous generations. And then we already talked about core skills for what constitutes an educated person. It's not the degrees and diplomas. It's the ability to adapt to learning in a lifelong manner. So I would just want to finish with one interesting thought. So at a time of a war in Ukraine, global challenges, and many other things, the question naturally comes up, what can I do as one individual? Let's not underestimate the power of one. One individual can have a huge impact on global society. There are many, many examples of this. I'll give you one example. Raoul Wallenberg was a Swedish diplomat of the Wallenberg family in Sweden, in Budapest, Hungary, around the time of the Second World War. Just that one person, he decided that he was going to save Jews from extinction. So he hid in the basement of the Swedish embassy thousands and thousands of Hungarian Jews and gave them fake passports so that they could escape Nazi Germany. And they escaped. Raoul Wallenberg disappeared. It is rumored, and in fact it's been confirmed, that he was abducted to Russia and he was never seen again. But he holds the Guinness Book of World Record for saving the most number of human beings from extinction. And he was only the second person to be given an honorary citizenship of the United States. The first one was Winston Churchill. And Wallenberg, one individual, played such an important role. The street that houses the Holocaust Museum in Washington, D.C. is named after him. So that's an example of the power of one. So at a time of despair and pessimism around the world on so many fronts, especially for young people like you, I want to give that example to show that you as an individual can have a huge impact on so many people. The second point here is around 2000, at the beginning of this century and this millennium, the US National Academy of Engineering released a list of the 20 greatest engineering achievements of the 20th century, collectively. Electrification, commercial aviation, the creation of the internet, advanced materials, microchips and computer technology, nuclear power, et cetera, et cetera. Then 4 years later, around 2004, the same National Academy of Engineering released another list of 14 grand challenges of the 21st century. Carbon sequestration, containing nuclear terror, securing cyberspace. So if you put the two lists side by side, the 14 grand challenges, many of them are a direct consequence of the 20 greatest engineering achievements of the 21st century. So if we were so smart as human race and as engineers in the 20th century and created all these wonderful inventions, what did we miss? How did we end up creating the 14 grand challenges? So what was missing in our thinking? And how do we fix it so that the greatest achievements of the 21st century don't become the grand challenges of the 22nd century? Our first grandson was just born 7 days ago. He will be in the 22nd century, so I'm thinking about it quite a bit as well. And many of you will be, based on life expectancy, will enter the 22nd century. So this is a question we want to think through. And what was missing? What was missing was we did not think about the consequences, the unintended consequences. We did not integrate social sciences and human behavior and humanity with technology to the extent we should have done. And that's one of the things we need to do in the 21st century so that we don't repeat our mistakes. So with that, I want to thank you for your attention. Thank you.
A true orator, educator, and an inspiration for all of us. Thank you, sir, for your words of wisdom. On behalf of everyone present here, I can say that you have inspired us to do better.
We will now have a panel discussion with students from our campus here in Singapore, while our sister campuses in Tokyo, Kuala Lumpur, and India will join us virtually. Over to the panelists.
Hello, how are you? Nice to meet you. Thank you. Nice to meet you. Nice to meet you.
Good morning, sir. My name is Rishil Gongler from Class 10 IGCSE, SMART Campus, Singapore. And these are my fellow panelists, Janvi Yadav, Bhakti Birla, and Amrit Yalai. It is an absolute honor to have you here with us, and we hope to learn a lot from this interaction. Besides us, we'll also be entertaining questions from our peers in other campuses like Tokyo, India, and Malaysia. With your permission, we would like to start this panel discussion. My question is, as a bioengineer, material scientist, and academic administrator, you have achieved several remarkable milestones in your career up till now. As children, we tend to have high hopes and often unrealistic dreams when it comes to our career choices and how our future will unfold. Did you always aim to achieve all the things that you have today, or did you have different ambitions as a child?
First of all, let me thank you all for joining. It's always a pleasure to interact with students, so thank you for joining me, and thank you for arranging this. The time in which I was your age, living in India at that time, the opportunities were far less than what you have. So in the late 60s and 70s, which may seem like long time ago for you, most people in India did not even have a landline phone. There's no internet, anything. So the way in which career evolved, a lot of it is serendipity and good luck rather than any extraordinary wisdom or ambition on my part. That's the reality. So at that time, I went to university. I took an entrance exam to the IITs and I got in. Did my undergraduate degree at IIT. At that time in India, the majority of the IIT students would go abroad for higher education. So when I finished my studies, I went to the US. And the natural progression was to do a PhD. So I went to the US, got a master's, then I went and got my PhD at MIT. Then things worked very well during my PhD. So the next thing was to do a postdoc. So I went to Berkeley. And then I received a faculty position at Brown. And so one thing led to another. Rather than any life ambition, I want to do this in the next 5 years or 10 years. I just followed where life took me. And so I ended up, even when I was introduced, when I got a call from the White House, from President Obama's administration to lead the US National Science Foundation. I had no idea that I was even a candidate. And one day I was sitting in my office, the phone rings, my executive assistant came in and said, somebody from the White House wants to talk to you. And the question was, you are one of our finalists. If the president offers you the job, will you take it? I said, why would I not take it? What am I going to negotiate? And they said, if that is the case, you'll have an interview tomorrow, and which is what happened. So life works in very interesting ways. But one of the lessons I learned was, while a lot of this is left to opportunities and chances, the decisions you make to pursue some of them, and equally the decisions you make not to pursue some of them, have a huge impact on the path you end up in. There are so many forks in the road, and Yogi Berra, who's a famous American baseball player, he's also claims to be a philosopher, he once said, when you come to a fork in the road, take it. He didn't say which side of the fork you need to take, but take it with a lot of deliberation.
Thank you so much, sir.
So our next question to you is from Yuna Ono, from grade CBSE 9, studying at GIIS Tokyo campus. Over to you, Yuna.
Yeah. Hello.
Hello, sir. I'm Yuna Ono from grade 9, GIIS Tokyo. I'm very glad to have this opportunity to interact with you today. I would like to know from you, your excellence and accomplishments and academics are exemplary and showcases your sheer hard work, dedication, and talent. How did your parents impact your growing up years, and how was your journey as a school student?
Yeah, great. Thank you for the question. Neither of my parents had a university degree. But I would say that, so I was the first in my immediate family to go to college or university. I think my mother played the most important role in this. She finished high school. In fact, she in India, and she was one of these people who was naturally curious, and for her time, way ahead of her time in so many ways. And she realized that, you know, if only she had the opportunity to go to university and get an education, how her career and her ambitions would have materialized. So right from a young age, she didn't really push us, but she nudged us, she encouraged us. So when it came time when I finished school, and was looking at universities, she said, there is no choice for you but to go to university. Why would you not go? So that propelled me to go to university. And when I finished my undergraduate degree, the natural thing for me was to go abroad. And I'm one of two children. My parents had they have a son and a daughter. I'm the son and I have a younger sister. The immediate reaction at that time would have been, why send the son so far away? You stay here. I could have easily received a job in India. She said, no, don't do that. You should go do your PhD. Try to go to the best university that you can possibly get into. And she had to make a lot of personal sacrifices. So I would say if there was one motivating factor, it was my mother. And the sacrifices that she made, she knew very well, probably I would settle in the US, which is what happened. But she was willing to make that sacrifice because she thought it was the right thing for me. And she had such a strong conviction that it was the right thing to do that she did not have a second thought about it.
Thank you, sir, for your words.
So my question to you is, you have served on the engineering and computer science jury and have also won the Infosys Prize in 2009 and 2010. Our graduates to be sitting here in the audience with us today are quite keen to know what this job as jury entailed and what was your experience in this role?
Yeah, thank you. Just one clarification. I was the chair of the jury. I was not a candidate for the prize. So I was in charge of selecting the winners of the prize. The Infosys Prize was set up by Mr. Narayanamurthy and also the other co-founders of Infosys, Mr. Chris Gopalakrishnan and many others, around 2008 or so. At that time, I was Dean of Engineering at MIT, and I was invited by Mr. Narayanamurthy to serve as the jury chair for the engineering prize. And so there was a prize for engineering, there was a prize for economics. There was Mr. Amartya Sen, the Indian origin Nobel laureate. He was the chair of the jury prize for economics and other prizes as well. And one of the interesting things, and Mr. Murthy and other co-founders of Infosys and the Infosys Foundation, they insisted that we want to inspire innovation in India and science and research in India. And it was very important that we set the bar very high. So when we deliberated, the other areas like economics, they had an automatic winner. That first year, the engineering jury, we decided that to follow Mr. Murthy's requirement, we decided that we did not want to offer a prize that year. It was a very difficult decision because if we didn't offer a prize, somebody would ask, and they did ask, you know, we have a country of more than a billion people. There is a lot of engineering innovation. Why do you think nobody is good enough to get a prize this year? Not because nobody is good enough to get a prize. Nobody who deserves the prize was nominated to receive the prize. So we didn't have a sufficiently good pool in the first year. So we made a decision not to give a prize, which was a very difficult decision to make, especially when there were prizes in other areas. But then in subsequent years, there were very good nominations, and we followed through this. I think prizes like this are very important in a place like India, because they motivate young people, and there is also an age limit. I think it was 50 or 55, beyond which you cannot get the prize. So I think it was a very good thing to do. It was wonderful of the Infosys team to create this prize.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
My question to you is, you have been an educator in numerous prestigious institutions like MIT, the director of the National Science Foundation, the president of Carnegie Mellon University and NTU Singapore, along with which you have also been a student in IIT, Iowa State University, as well as MIT. How would you say the education system has evolved over the years as you have progressed from a student to an educator yourself?
I think just a few very general observations. I think the current cohort of students like you, you are much more global, much more aware of issues, local and global issues, much more worldly, more articulate than I was when I was your age. Absolutely, by far. The opportunities you have are far more than what we had, not just in India, but in many parts of the world. You see that in students. So unlike many people of my age and my generation, I firmly believe that the current generation is better than the previous generation, which is better than the previous generation. So I don't subscribe to the fact that good old days, you know, it's not like the good old days. I'm an optimist, and I think the future will be better despite all the challenges that I talked about. And I do believe with a lot of hope and enthusiasm that these challenges will be overcome, even though there'll be new challenges that we don't know about. And that your generation will come. But I think the current generation is much more well prepared, much better prepared than probably I was when I was leaving high school, for example. So that's one. Secondly, I think education has evolved in many interesting ways. There was a dominance of education in a few institutions, like the Ivy League schools, MIT, Harvard, Stanford, other universities in the US, Cambridge, Oxford, et cetera, IITs. But increasingly, universities in different parts of the world are emerging very rapidly. Institutions like NTU did not even exist when I was an undergraduate student. In fact, just 10 days ago, we were talking earlier, there was assessment by a US organization of global universities. There are five subjects from material science to other areas, energy and fuels and so forth, where universities in Singapore and Asia, including NTU, are ranked at the top in the world. So there is a shift that's taking place, and it'll take a long time because academia has a very long time constant, and it won't happen overnight. So that's one. The second major shift that I think that your generation has an opportunity to do in education and innovation is it is no longer centralized. So I'll give you one example of this. In the 1960s, when President John F. Kennedy was the president of the US, he famously announced that we will put human beings on the moon before the decade is over. He said, we'll put man on the moon before the decade is over and bring him home back safely. We put men and women in space since that time. But here is so that galvanized generations of people, especially Americans, to go into science and engineering, because that's where the moonshot term came about. So moonshots are very important to motivate people. But somebody actually pointed out, which is true, Neil Armstrong set foot on the moon in 1969. But it took us much later to put wheels on a suitcase, which is a much smaller innovation, which is much more useful on the ground. Wheels have been around for a long, long time, and suitcases have been around for a long, long time. The first patent to combine wheels and suitcase was filed in Massachusetts after Neil Armstrong set foot on the moon. So the point I'm trying to make is innovation comes in large flavors. Some are really visible, like the Moonshot project. Some are not so visible as putting wheels on the suitcase. But wheels on the suitcase is probably much more useful to you and me on a daily basis than going to the moon right now. So I think that kind of distributed innovation, small-scale innovation, and also local individual innovation is as important today than government-sponsored massive NASA project or an energy project. So your generation has an opportunity. We already see this through startups and many other things. So that's something completely new, and that has transformed education and innovation as well.
Thank you for that interesting take, sir.
Sir, my next question to you is, as the first Asian-born professor to lead many of the five schools in MIT, and one of the first and the first Asian-born scientist to lead the National Science Foundation, what obstacles did you face in the journey of earning a leadership, such as one of a director? And during your time in charge, what goals did you set, and what changes or actions did you implement?
Yeah, thank you. So I think, you know, one of the things that I really appreciated about the U.S. is, like any society, and U.S. is no different today, and we see greater fissures in society today than even 10, 20 years ago in the U.S. and around the world. One of the things that I really appreciated was the fact that when I joined Brown University in the 1980s in engineering, Brown was founded in 1770 as one of the original Ivy League schools. When I joined as a faculty member, I was in my 20s. And in engineering, I was the first India-born to be hired as a faculty member, this 213 years after Brown was created. So it was not directly automatic that even though in principle, the opportunities were open to anybody from anywhere, of any origin, of any background, you cannot take it for granted that the opportunities were equal. But at the same time, that particular recruitment process, there were hundreds of applicants from around the world. It did not matter to them that I was not born in the US. And same with the National Science Foundation. When President Obama nominated me to lead the National Science Foundation, I had to go through a very rigorous vetting process in the White House, security clearance, and many other things. And one of the things that I asked them, you do know that I was not born in the US, and you do know that I'm not registered for any political party, and I don't have any political background to come and work in Washington. And what was remarkable at that time was it did not matter to them where I was born, what color my skin was, what accent I had, and all that mattered was, and I think, I hope we don't lose that as a, not just for the US, but as a global society, because globalization, there has to be free movement of people. And if we lose that, I think, you know, it'll be a shame for global society, for humanity. Your question about the National Science Foundation, what vision I had, one of the things that from my MIT days that I thought was very important. So when I was director of the National Science Foundation, the budget of NSF was about $7 billion, about 10 billion Singapore dollars a year. Now it's more, it's close to $10 billion. And NSF was and still is the largest basic science and engineering funding agency in the world. So you do fundamental research in every field of science and engineering, including social sciences, economics. So for example, since its founding in 1950, the National Science Foundation has supported 260 American Nobel Prize winners for some significant portion of their Nobel Prize winning work, which is a remarkable achievement. I don't know of any other agency in the world that has had that much success in creating innovation and entrepreneurship. So one of the things I realized when I started was the fact that every research project that's funded by the NSF leads to publications. Many of them lead to patents, but very few go beyond that. Not because people are not entrepreneurial or innovative, but because they don't have the opportunity. So even within the US, if you live on the East Coast or the West Coast, you have a lot of opportunities. If you live in small states that are far away from big urban centers, you may not have a technology licensing office in your university, even though you may be just as innovative as somebody on either coast, somebody in Silicon Valley. So to support that, I started a program called the NSF Innovation Core or iCore program. So we started with the, and one of the lessons learned in that program was most of the people in my own agency at that time felt that why start it? We're already doing it. We are very successful. We produce so many Nobel Prize winners. Why waste money? But fortunately for me, the White House was strongly supportive of this. So now it has become one of the most successful programs. So I started with $1 million a year in a $7 billion budget. Today, Congress has approved almost $70 million a year for the same program. So that program has created 1,500 startups across the US in all states. So one of the lessons learned is sometimes, even if there is no immediate support for it, if it's the right thing to do, go for it.
Thank you, sir.
Our next question is from Kushagri Saxena of Grade 10, studying in GIIS Hatapsar India campus. Over to you, Kushagri.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
I am Kushagri Saxena from Grade 10, GIIS SMART Campus, Hatapsar. My question to you is, GIIS has always emphasized the importance of students' holistic growth. Our award-winning 9GEMS model has always encouraged us, students, to take the learning beyond academics with an equal focus on sports, skills, and values. How important do you think the all-around development of student is?
I think it's a great question. I think it's very important on many different levels. One of our daughters went to a small school, a very good school in Boston called Windsor. And I remember the motto of that school, which is very, very much aligned with your question, a sound mind in a sound body. And they also emphasize sports. I think especially with so many things that are done online, sitting in front of computers most of the day, whether it's Zoom calls or even studying for exams and things like this, the need for things like sports cannot be overemphasized. I think it's going to be very important, physical activity, especially with a growing epidemic of at all age groups, not just elderly, but also younger generation, obesity and so forth. I think it's very, very important that sports and physical activity are important, not necessarily to win medals and awards, but to at least keep physically fit and have the desire to be physically active. So, but much broader than sports itself, I think some of the things that I mentioned in my presentation, values of ethics, communication, a global perspective, are going to be very critical. I think that's why schools like GIIS are very important. And also the opportunities you have today to engage globally are unprecedented, and it's only going to grow. I think having this well-roundedness, the only thing I would say is that while well-roundedness is very important in life, whether you could be a scientist or an engineer, but if you don't appreciate the arts and the music, what good is just being a good scientist or a good engineer? And conversely, if you're a musician, or if you don't know how to turn on your computer, you're not going to be very successful in the 21st century. So I think both sides are going to be very important. But having said that, it's probably a good idea to be good and deep in something. So you're not a complete all-rounder, but there is something unique about you and about your talent and about your profession or your hobby. So trying to balance that is the challenge.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, my next question to you is, you have received a degree from IIT, a master's degree in mechanical engineering from Iowa State University, and a PhD in mechanical engineering from MIT. Nowadays, to remain focused, especially for degrees that require a lot of dedication, students don't seem to be able to find the motivation and often switch between subjects of interest. So how did you, in these 5 years, stay motivated and focused? What advice do you have to the next generation of scientists and engineers?
Excellent question. So in fact, I was referring to some of this experience recently at another event just earlier this week. So when I joined IIT, I have to step back a little bit. When I joined school, primary school, there was no minimum age requirement in India. So if your parents take you to school, doesn't matter. So my mother took me to, we were living in South India, in Tamil Nadu at that time. And the reason she took me to a local school was my sister who was just born, and she had difficulty managing me in particular with my sister. So she just took me to the local school and asked the principal, you know, do you have kindergarten? Can you put him in kindergarten so I can focus on my second child? They said, we don't have any kindergarten. We have only first grade. So she said, can you take him? I said, well, he's a little bit young to go into first grade. She was very persuasive, as I mentioned earlier. She talked him into taking me. So I started school. So I finished high school when I was 15. So when I entered IIT, I was 16. So at 16, you really don't have I didn't have a clue as to what I wanted. So IIT was 5 years. We had 8 years of mathematics, seven or eight semesters of mathematics, 4 years. Lot of physics, lot of chemistry, 4 semesters of English, 1 semester of technical German, because IIT Madras had a German connection. At that time, I thought it was a waste of time. Why do I have to do so much mathematics, so much physics? But much later in life, 20 years later, when I tried to move from engineering to physics and materials physics and material science, I realized that all that mathematics that I did 25 years ago came in handy. It gave me the confidence, even though I didn't remember most of the things. I think a lot of these kinds of things that we don't appreciate as students now come in handy. The only major gaping hole in my undergraduate education was there was no biology at that time. I wish I had a good grounding in biology. And regarding your question about how much time do you spend in university versus starting a company or going to work for a company, I wouldn't assume that doing a PhD will take a long time. So I'll give you just one data point from my life. It may not be representative, but it is possible. At that time, the undergraduate degree was 5 years. I had no choice. Now it's 4 years. Fortunately, I started early, so I finished before I was 21. When I went to Iowa State to do a master's, just the set of circumstances that I found myself in, pretty much everything I touched did not work. My experiments didn't work. I didn't have the funding to do my master's thesis, etc. So it took me 1 year and 9 months to get my master's degree. No fault of Iowa State. It was just the set of circumstances. But they gave me full scholarship. I stayed, I finished my master's, then I applied to MIT to go do my PhD. So I arrived in Boston. Nothing changed. I was no different. But everything I touched worked. So it took me 1 year and 9 months to do my PhD.
same time it took me to do my master's. So I would not make an assumption that doing a PhD will take a long time. It may, but it need not. So a lot of it depends on luck and you, your advisor, and many other circumstances. So it's very individual-based. A lot of luck plays into it, but also hard work and other things play into it. I think having a good background in any field, mechanical engineering, you asked about mechanical engineering and moving into other fields. I did move quite a bit into biomedicine about 20 years ago while I was head of material science and engineering department. So I was trained, all my degrees are in mechanical engineering. I was head of material science department and I was trying to get into biomedical engineering and trying to have a joint appointment at Harvard Medical School. And at the same time, I think the education that I received was sufficiently robust, and I'm confident that the education you receive here will prepare you very well for to move into it. It just requires a bit of confidence and also a lot of hard work and ability to accept with humility, some humiliation as well, because I was very well known in my field. When I tried to go into a new field, nobody in that field knew who I was. So it took a few years to establish yourself. And I think it is possible, and it's going to be increasingly necessary in the future, because no field is going to stay static for a long period of time.
Thank you so much, sir. Oh, our next question is from GIIS Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia, by Ms. Ria Salian.
Good morning, sir. I'm Ria Salian from GIIS Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. I'm from Class 11 CBSE. My question to you is, over the years, you have mentored numerous students and have seen how the education industry has evolved. What, according to you, is the future of education in terms of teaching, learning, and assessment?
So I think we are at a very interesting point in education, because technology, on the one hand, has enabled so many things, so many opportunities to learn. Online course materials, things like Coursera and edX that offer courses from anywhere in the world. As if you have internet access for a relatively modest fee, one can learn from some of the best experts in the world and learn at one's own pace from the comfort of home if one is motivated enough. So all that is really phenomenal. At the same time, there are areas, you know, engineering, mechanical engineering is an example, biology, medicine. You cannot learn everything online. You have to try with your hands, and you have to go to the lab. You have to make things, break things, learn the hard way, just like learning to drive. Even though driving is a lot easier now, you don't have to manually shift gears the way I learned to drive and so forth. So I think still, there has to be a balance, and also, as I mentioned earlier, there has to be a balance between adopting technology and keeping a distance from technology to preserve some creativity and innovation. I think that's very individualistic. You know, what works for me may not work for you, and vice versa. So I think one has to figure that out, and the good thing you have is you have an opportunity to figure it out much earlier in life than I had the opportunity to learn. So you are much more nimble and adaptable, and you have the opportunity to learn and figure out at a much earlier point in life than I had. So I think all of that is very good. In terms of also, one of the privileges of being in the education field is I have no choice. This is my choice to be in the education sector, but one of the things it really forces me in a university is I constantly deal with people who are 18 to 24 years old in Singapore. As a result of this, you have to be mentally young. And in a school like GIIS, it's even younger. You have to work with teenage students, and who are much more worldly than previous generations. So it keeps us mentally nimble. So one of the privileges for me is to continuously keep in touch with the younger generation and to learn from it. Because you know a lot more about the world than I did when I was your age. So the opportunity for you to learn is very different from the opportunities that I had. That means we have to tailor our learning. And the other point we have to work together is how to make you successful when you leave GIIS, when you leave a university. And I cannot use my IIT example because it's irrelevant in today's context. So I think it keeps both sides very nimble and it's much more global. So one of the privileges of my career is that when I go to Korea, because GIIS also has a Korean campus, I have 14 PhD students who worked in my lab who are now professors in Korea. Every time I go, they are like my academic children. I know their children. I know their students who are my academic grandchildren. So we are a family. We are a global family. When I go to Japan, people who worked in my lab who live in Japan. So it's a global family, and it's a very unique global community. And GIIS, you are very fortunate to be here because you are already a global community and you're calling from Kuala Lumpur. And so even though it's not very far away, it's in a different country. So I think it's that's the excitement of today's world in education.
Thank you so much, sir, for your insightful views and for dedicating your time to come here and grace us with your presence. This has truly been an inspirational discussion, and I'm pretty sure all of us will start inculcating your advice into our lives from here on.
Yeah, thank you. It's my pleasure and privilege. Thank you.
May I now request Professor Suresh to sign the guest book. Thank you, sir.
May I request Mr. Thermanicker to please felicitate our guest? Thank you, sirs. May we now request you to have a seat in the audience?
Nice to meet you. You speak very well.
With this, we come to the end of the Leadership Lecture Series. On behalf of GIIS, I would like to thank Professor Subra Suresh for taking time out of his busy schedule to share with us his interesting thoughts. I am certain that everyone present here has a lot to take away from his speech and the panel session. We would also like to extend our gratitude to the enthusiastic panel of students who volunteered to make this session enlightening. Lastly, we thank the audience for their cooperation and support throughout the session. It was wonderful to have you all here. Thank you once again and have a great day ahead.
So some of you were in the lecture and many of you heard about what sir talked about. Any comments would you like to offer from your side?
Good day. They will not comfortable seeing you.
It was very like, it was very repeated that you don't really need to do other sections of you. You can follow your own path. And it resonates a lot with what my father always taught me. So it felt good to hear.
Also, I think it was good to see the opportunities that you can get if you take the opportunities. I think that was the central takeaway, that if you have opportunities, just take them so that you can develop from them.
Sometimes it's easy to overanalyze, and then you make the wrong decision. Just plunge into it. You don't want to plunge into it too quickly. But
so I think that is what we are faced with right now. We're all in like a final year of high school, so we do have to decide on colleges, the subjects we want to pursue. So your advice about the fork in the road, so to say, I mean, I think that's very helpful because we do tend to overthink our university decisions and our subject choices. So that's good to hear that no matter which path you take, if you continue on it and you take all the opportunities, that you can still succeed. And
the other thing I wanted to, I didn't want to say it because it's very tricky and it depends on individual circumstances, because you'll get a lot of advice from not just parents, grandparents, uncles and aunts, and your life is very different from theirs, you know. So that's what I was trying to convey, that circumstances under which I grew up, and I can give a lot of advice to, we have two daughters, and we just had a
now first, grandfather.
No, our grandson was just born 10 days ago, and you know, it's easy for me to give advice, but their lives are very different from mine, so it doesn't always work. So you have to also balance respecting your family but following your own passion as well. That's a delicate balance.
How many of you are looking to study, continue in Singapore for the graduate? Any of you?
How many are want to go abroad? And so you're hedging your bets. So where would you like to go? Sorry?
Canada.
Canada? Why Canada?
Well, my dream university is British Columbia. And Vancouver?
I see. Do you have relatives there?
I don't actually.
That's why you want to go there. How about you?
I hope I get into a university in the US. I till now applied to like 4 universities, 2 of them being Brown and MIT. So it was kind of a celebratory moment when I saw you. I was like, oh my God.
So both our daughters were born near Brown. You cannot go wrong with any of those
courses. Welcome to GIIS SMART Campus.
So you all, those who are graduating, you taken your exams and all this already? So like SAT and...
Yes, sir.
So temporarily during COVID, they had stepped back from those. Now they have reinstated.
So, but I believe a lot of them are going digital, like the SAT as well is going completely digital in the next 2 weeks or so.
So I think one of our students has, you've written a book, right?
Yes, sir.
Could you share about that?
I lived in Pakistan for 4 years. My father's in the Indian Navy. So we moved there when I was 6. So I did all my elementary education in Pakistan. So I wrote a book about it that came out in March of this year. It's called My Sambhadai. So I want to pursue international relations, but I'm also applying to the US, the whole concept of a liberal arts education my fondness for it came from my time in Pakistan, because experiencing a country where, because I did all my other education in India, experiencing a country where there's a lot of rhetoric about India-Pakistan relationships, and I heard a lot about, oh my god, you live in Pakistan, when I came back to India, to just write about how I experienced the culture, the community there, without any sense of bias, because I was 7 years old, I didn't know about India-Pakistan.
Where are you planning to pursue international policy?
Like in the US.
Where in the US? Any particular place?
Yeah, well, the dream is Yale.
Yeah.
So hopefully that works out. But I'm applying to Brown as well. So a bunch of places, also to a few liberal arts, small colleges. So,
quite a few.
Yeah, so.
Anybody would like to share anything interesting on this side? What's your choices?
So you mentioned about the importance of learning how to learn, and that knowledge might get outdated if you like don't keep up to date with the recent developments. And there's been recent news about Singaporean universities planning to add expiry dates to the degrees that they offer as well, so that once they reach the date, they can do crash courses as well, and then stay up to date with the latest technologies and stuff, the advancements. So what do you think is your opinion on this decision?
So I think, you know, for example, at NTU, we offer each one of our graduates $1,600 in credits. I mean, it's not that much, but you can, let's say you graduated 8 years ago and you didn't learn anything about AI and you want to study, you can take an online module and you don't even have to pay for it, no matter where you are in the world. And if you're a Singaporean, on top of it, you get matching subsidies from the government. So you can almost get a free credits in any area you choose. It could be energy, it could be sustainability, AI, machine learning, any of these things. So those kinds of things are going to be increasingly not only important, but sought after in the future.
Directly to the kind of theme that we're talking about, but I was curious, how does one attain 18 honorary PhDs?
It's undeserved and unearned.
I'm sure, sir, that's not true. I'm sure.
So it just shows that you get old and you have a lot of friends. They invite you.
Is the biggest highlight of your life.
So for different things it's different. I think meeting with Obama in the Oval Office and talking to him, that was definitely an unforgettable experience during my Washington time. So I probably met him 6 or 7 times in different venues, but maybe at least 5-6 times in the Oval Office, one-on-one. And he's a remarkable individual. In terms of human interactions. The other really memorable event was a dinner meeting in Berlin with Angela Merkel. And so the president of the German National Science Foundation became a close friend when I was head of the US National Science Foundation. So I was in Berlin for a meeting, and my German friends, they were all talking in German about the dinner, and I don't understand German, but I picked up a few words here and there. I heard Merkel, dinner, and Berlin. So those are the only things I could understand. So I said, what is this dinner? I said, every year, you know, she's a PhD in physics. Her husband is a PhD in chemistry. So every year, just before Christmas, apparently they have a small group of a few couples. They get together in Berlin and they have a private dinner. So I said, no, it must be exciting, because then they said, how many times have you had dinner with the US president? I said, you must be joking, you know, we don't have these kinds of traditions. So this was in October of 2011. I went back to US. 2 weeks later, I get this email from Germany. Oh, the dinner is set this year. We would like to invite you and your wife. So we went there, and it was on a Sunday evening in one of the hotels. There were 6 couples, and we were the only non-German speaking couple. So it was a table a little bigger than this,
12 people around the table. So I was sitting here and she was sitting here for 4 hours. And there was an unforgettable experience. She speaks excellent English. Her husband's English is not so good. And very has a great sense of humor. So that's another thing I remember. Two other things I remember are all four experiences were during NSF. So I went to the South Pole. I stood at the South Pole also in 2011. So we have a research station at the geographic South Pole. And so I spent a day there and spent 5 days in Antarctica. And then we went to the highest point of the Arctic Circle. So you take a US military plane, there's no commercial flight. We take off on wheels, but we land on skis. So it's a plane about the size of an A380. It's a large cargo plane. And it just lands on skis. So it's a remarkable experience. So those are four really memorable moments.
Well, thank you so much. You want to ask something?
So you spoke about how you started off from mechanical engineering, then moved on to being interested in material sciences, then went interested in biomedicine. So like for students like of this generation, so supposing like I'm applying for economics, but I'm also interested in data science and computer science, how possible do you think it would be to switch from industries as we develop?
Especially in the Western context, even in NTU, it's not an issue. You can do a number of different things. You can do a double major, and most universities have that. And you can do an undergraduate degree in something and then do a master's or something. For example, if you want to go to medical school in the US, you have to have an undergraduate degree first. And there are people who major in history, psychology, philosophy, and then go to medical school. I mean, you have to spend 4 years doing it, but so I think these kinds of things are increasingly possible. And one of our daughters, she did her undergraduate degree in neuroscience at MIT, and then she went to medical school. So she's a practicing pediatric pulmonologist in California. Another daughter did double major in undergraduate education at Wesleyan. She double majored in biology and French in 4 years. So it is possible in most universities, and a lot of students, you want to enjoy life as well. Don't cram too much into it, otherwise you lose the fun. But it is possible, at a reasonable pace, while having fun, to do a double major in very different fields within a university. Most universities allow this.
Even in Singapore, it's allowed.
Yeah.
Especially in the US. I think that's what attracts a lot of us who are applying to the US. But then you also spoke of the fissures in society that are more present now than ever before in the US. And that's, I think, a concern that a lot of us have in terms of the legislation that's being passed recently. So what is the, if you know of the situation in the educational institutions itself, what is the fissure that affects the systems of education in the US?
So a lot of the geopolitical do indirectly affect the universities now. For example, Russia's invasion of Ukraine, for example, it is just about impossible for any Russian scientist to get a visa to come to the US. And even in the top universities in the US, they are not that open because of the war, ongoing war, to have collaboration, joint publications, joint research with Russian scientists, which unfortunately is not good for science. I mean, it's not the fault of the scientists that there is a war in Ukraine. So that's one consequence. The other consequence is the US-China trade tension. The flow of American scientists to China and Chinese scientists to the US has been severely curtailed in the last couple of years. And China being one of the largest suppliers of human talent around the world, I think that's going to have a negative effect. That affects universities in a big way. Then there are other things, political things. You want to have free speech in universities and
many universities are in the middle of this, trying to draw a politically correct line, and that's going to be a continuing challenge as well. Some universities are very good at managing it and others are not. So those are the fissures. Then you have the whole issue of inequality. You know, you take any of the Ivy League schools, access to those schools, unfortunately, depends on how wealthy your family is. And if you come from an underprivileged family, it's not that easy to get into. Even though they give a lot more scholarships, they opened it up quite a bit. It's still not enough. It's still an uphill climb for people. So those are the things that affect universities in a very adverse way. Even in India, getting into an IIT has become an industry compared to my time.
So the quotas. Yeah. So I just wanted to say thank you. During the presentation, when you mentioned about the quotas, technology tends to take away from the imperfections in the world that makes us human. The world being exceedingly symmetric, it takes away from authenticity.
Yeah.
That was something that I think you mentioned it, and I immediately, I'm sitting next to you, and immediately got up because it reminded me of the Japanese philosophical concept of wabi sabi, that there is beauty in imperfections. That I thought.
I use the word truth, but truth and beauty, but authenticity is a very good term as well. Because it becomes a little bit, you have atomic clocks that precisely measure the time. You are 1 minute late, and you are chastised in certain circumstances, right? So my fear is that, I hope I'm wrong. I hope I'm completely wrong. It takes away from creativity. Most of the creative people, some of the best professors and scientists are really absent-minded. They cannot even remember whether they had lunch or not. A necessary condition to be a university professor. You talk to yourself and you have no idea what you did in the morning. And so things
happen. When you were studying biomedical and mechanical engineering, how did you deal with anything such as boredom or productivity loss or stress? How did you deal with that?
In school or as a student? So, I don't know what I'm sure the living conditions are rich. At that time, when I was an undergraduate student, it was a 5-year undergraduate degree. We lived in hostels that had no facility. Actually, we didn't have a television. No television, no phone. One landline phone for 100 students. So, no mobile devices, no computer, no internet. We had an IBM mainframe where you punch cards. I look like I was born in the 10th century or something, but it's not that long ago.
Size is much larger than the whole area.
And so just to learn computer programming, it was Fortran program at that time. 5 years is a long time, and especially in my case, I started age 16, I finished at age 21. That's a very significant part of your life. And you have no basis for calibration, and at that time there was really no boredom because the life was very rich. Especially young people are very creative, right? If you don't have a television, we didn't even have newspapers. It was 3 days later, news was old. You had radio, even things like football and cricket matches, you listen to the radio because there's nothing else to watch. But you are very imaginative, so you have human bonds. So now I have the benefit of hindsight, 50 years later, 40 some years later, many of the students who went to school, there is an immediate bond. So I have one advice for all of you. So people standing next to you 40 years from now, they'll be CEOs of some big company. So be nice to them now. Be nice to them, forge all the friendships, keep in touch. It could come in very handy. You could get some honorary degree somewhere. So that's how you get 18. be nice to your friends.
Well, thank you so much, everyone. We will take a group photo.
Sure.
Can we just move on the side here?